Hello everyone, my name is Raman. Today in this video, I want to show you a game between Benjamin Joel versus Christiansen Larimar. It was played in the year 1981. Benjamin Joel with white has a rating of 2405 and black with Christiansen Larimar has a rating of 2575. So pretty strong players. So white started with e4, black played g5. Caro can defense, d4, d5, e takes d5, c takes d5, exchange variation of Karakhan, and after bishop d3, knight f6, c3, knight c6, this is a Pano-Botvinnik attack, not exactly but still a kind of, after bishop g4, bishop f4, bishop g4, attacking the queen, so the bishop is supported with the knight, so after queen b3, queen d7 attacking the pawn, protecting the pawn, queen d7, knight d2, e6, knight gf3. The important move is white didn't play knight f3 immediately because he can capture and it allows double pawn. So he played knight d2 first and then he played knight f3 because of if bishop takes, as in the game, knight takes. So the pawn structure is not disturbed. So bishop d6, bishop takes, queen takes, and then castles. So one thing here is, This is a Carlsbad pawn structure. The main ideas are to have a minority attack so that's important thing. As black is playing on the king side, it's white who has to play on the king side. I mean, it's a kind of general rule. There is no specific rule, but it's a kind of general rule. So rook a1, rook b8. Yeah, one thing is there is nothing to play immediately a6 b5, but since we can always play rook b8 and then we can play b5 immediately, because for example if black plays b5 now, bishop takes and pawn push just wins a piece for white. So after knight e5, b5, a3, e5, yeah. So here if black is allowed a move, for example let's say h3 or something like that, no move, then if black immediately plays b4, destroying the trying to open up the pawn structure and creating some weakness on the king side, on the queen side. So that's the reason a3 to not allow b4. a5 was played and b4, a takes, queen d1. So if for example let's say h3, if h3, black will take on c3 and we cannot take back with the pawn having a connected pawn because the rook will be attacked, so we need to take with the rook. So the b pawn will be much weaker on b2 than c3. So white retreated his queen back. Since his queen side is weak, he has to do something on the king side or in the center. And so he's regrouping his pieces. Although right now g4 and h5 are not available, but still he's trying to attack. He will attack on the king side if chance is allowed. Yeah. Okay, let us stop in this position. The chances are equal, that doesn't mean that it is in a kind of boring way or something. It's a kind of not a very much dynamic position, but still it's a kind of dynamic position. White has a pretty much weakness on his queen side. C3 pawn is a very much weakness. So also note that we cannot exchange our weakness by playing c4 because then the d4 pawn will become a weakness. So that's important to note. Hence, if white doesn't create his own counterplay on the king side, then he will pretty much lose his pawns on the c3 pawn and d4 pawn, and he will lose. So that's one important thing to note. Yeah, here knight d7 was played. The other alternatives are knight e7 or even rook fc8. So yeah, knight d7 and queen e1. So queen e1 with the idea of either to something like maybe queen to h5, queen to h4, and then follow it up with something like rook h3. So yeah, knight c takes e5 was played. The other alternatives are rook to b7, or even rook to b3, trying to attack the weakness, or rook b7, just trying to protect, or something like that. I mean, it allows multiple ideas. It allows to protect the f7 pawn and h7 pawn. So that's one thing to note. Queen e7, knight c takes e5, and f takes e5. Here, I mean, when we look at this position, from a human eye, at least for me, I think white's chances are better here. I would prefer white because I have a semi-open f file, and I think my pieces will have a very good. I mean, I will have a very good play, very easy play, I should say, and always the sacrifices on g6 are always in the air. So that's one thing to note. Queen e7, rook e f3, f5. So f5 trying to close down the position. Note that now all the pawns are in the light square. So now it looks good, but the position is completely locked. So I think bishop will be not so much useful when it compares to his opponent knight. So here en passant is possible. So we need to open up the position. We need to create more weaknesses as much as possible. So for example, when the pawn was on f7, the g6 pawn is reinforced two times. But now it's currently reinforced only one time. So that's one important thing to note. And after rook takes knight takes, rook f3. The other alternative is going to play queen a3. So, rook e8. So yeah, here. After rook f3, rook e8 was played, but e5 is a far better move than what was played. E5 is a far better move than what is played. So rook e8 was played. So h3, knight d7, bishop b5, rook f8. So yeah, black is trying to exchange as many pieces as possible just to have some air, and white is trying to avoid, because one important rule to remember is when you are attacking, try to keep as many pieces as possible on the board, and when you are defending, try to exchange as many pieces as possible. So black is trying to for example if white takes on f8, he can either take with the king or with the knight, but not with the queen, because then the knight will be undefended. So yeah, that's one thing to note. So here other alternatives are to play queen to t6 and then try to follow it up with e5. So yeah, so rook e3, rook f6. Yeah, another important idea to play the move rook to f8 is to come and protect the e6 pawn. Yeah, and rook e3, rook f6, queen g3, knight f8. Now the knight is protecting the two main weakness on the blanks in the black's camp, and king h2, queen f7, bishop e2, rook f4, some regrouping of pieces, bishop g4, rook f6, rook e2, g5. Yeah, so I don't think g5 is a very good move. I mean black's idea was to I guess black's idea was to play knight d6 and follow it up with e5, trying to liberate a kind of his position, or trying to eliminate his weakness, but already black's position, I think black is a little bit worse here, especially he's the play is going on the king side, so it's better not to move any more pawns on the king side, because whenever your opponent is playing on one side of the board, try not to move the pawns until and unless it is necessary or compulsory, or it is forced, because you will only advance his attack. So that's one thing to note. G5, queen e5, h6. So yeah, so now one 3 pieces are attacking on the e6 pawn, and 1, 2, 3 pieces are defending. So the number of attackers equal to number of defenders, so nothing happens. So if you want to win a material, the number of attackers should be more than the number of defenders. So that's one thing to remember as well. So yeah, so here white's advantage is I think pretty damn high. Although there is a weakness on the c3, the c3 pawn is a weakness, but I don't think it's completely relevant. I mean, it's completely relevant here. So after h6, rook b2. So now all black's pieces are on the king's side. So white is not trying to play on the queen side, but trying to invade his position through either of he's shifting his rook to the queen side so that he can attack through the queen side. That's important idea. And rook f4 and rook e2, rook f6. Black is doing nothing here. So rook e1, king g7, rook a1, king g6, rook a8. I don't think rook a8 is the best move here. I think rook a6 gives a very good advantage to white. So rook a8 was played, and h5. Yeah, as I already mentioned, h5 is a weakness. Why? Because we are already weak on the king's. I mean, black is already weak on the king side. So pushing his pawn further only weakens his position more. That's the reason. H5. Simple rook f1, and then simple maneuvering his pieces back and here and there. And I think it will be okay for him. I mean, it will at least prolong the game. So yeah, after which b2. Yeah, when we look at this position, I think white is much much better here. So as you can see, the knight is doing nothing, and these two pawns are weakness, and the king position is also very weak. So rook f2, king g1, king h6, h4, rook f5. Queen h8. So queen h8. Now the knight is attacked. We cannot play queen to h7 because the rook can capture the knight, and when we try to capture the queen, we can capture with the rook. So that's thing. And when we try to capture the rook, we can capture with the queen back. So that's important to note. Hence knight h7 is a move. And bishop d3. So yeah, so I mean, let's stop this position and let's see what happens. So why do you think black played the move g takes h4? Why do you think black played the move g takes h4 and not try to save his rook? Yeah, so I mean, I just gave you time to think. So yeah, so bishop d3, and here he took the pawn. Why? Let's suppose black played something like any rook move. It needs to move from the protection of the g5 pawn. For example, let's say if rook f4, then we can simply take and note that blacking has no escape. No escape squares. So he has to come forward, and he has to take the pawn, and then we can simply, white can simply take the knight either with. I don't think taking with bishop is a good idea because there is a check on f1. So I think simple queen takes, and then white is a piece up. So yeah, that's the reason he gave up an exchange. And bishop takes f5, queen takes f5. And from here there is no explanation needed. White converted his material advantage without any big troubles. So yeah, rook a7, queen b1. Rook a7 is nothing. Rook a7 is a move which ties down the two pieces. I mean, the queen cannot move from the protection of the from the protection of the knight. So yeah, queen b1 check, king h2, queen g6. Also notice that the black queen is on, the black queen is on a light square, and the white king is on a dark square. So I mean, it has to stay on the b1 h7 diagonal, which is completely a light square. So he's putting his king on the dark square so that there will be no checks and no perpetuals. I mean, it's a very good strategy. I mean, it's a very good thing to remember, in especially in blitz, if you are in time table or in blitz games. So yeah, queen g6 and queen e5, knight f6, queen f4 check, queen g5, queen takes. So the white rook is cutting off the escape square for the king, so queen should be exchanged. Check, and king h3, knight e4, king takes, knight takes, and king takes, knight e2, g4 check, king e4, g5, king takes, rook f7. Yeah, and the idea of rook f7 is to cover the square, to cover the f4 square, which could do something like this. So which could fork something. So yeah, and here black resigned. So yeah, that's it in this video. I hope you like this video. There are some important points to note that I explained through this game. So yeah, that's all in this video. I hope you like this video. So what do you want me to make next in my videos? Like, do you want me to make some games of the games with instructional points like this, or do you want me to cover some end games, or do you want me to cover some calculation exercise or anything? Please comment and let me know. I will cover them in my next videos. And yeah, I hope you like this video. Please subscribe to my channel for more videos. Thank you for watching. Have a good day.